everybody. It's Dr. Newman again, here to talk to you about hemodialysis access. I'm going to skip through some of the slides we've already been through today, and I will begin with hemodialysis access. They're listed here as temporary and permanent. Temporary usually indicates that someone is undergoing dialysis and it's for a temporary problem such as toxin removal or immediate removal of high potassium not related to acute renal failure. Catheters are listed here as a temporary access, but you can also have a permanent catheter access, and we'll get into that a little bit further along. More permanent solutions to hemodialysis access are the AV fistula and the AV graft. We're going to explore those more in detail. The temporary hemodialysis access catheter is shown here in this picture. In this picture, there are two ports, the red port and the blue port, one being for blood from the body and one being for returning blood to the body from the machine. We'll get into a little bit more of the specifics of those. Sometimes you'll often see a hemodialysis catheter that has three ports, such as the one I've showed you in class. And that one has what's called a pigtail, which is the third port. It's very small, it's usually brown, and it's used to administer IV fluids separate of the hemodialysis process. Oftentimes, patients will get a dose of albumin if their blood pressure has dropped too low, and it might be given through that port, or also vancomycin as an antibiotic or any other type of medication that needs to go through the IV, but not necessarily through the dialysis machine. Sometimes it depends on your manufacturer of where you're working and where the company that you're working for, the types of catheters that they provide. So don't be surprised as you're out in your permanent practice as a registered nurse that you see different types of temporary hemodialysis catheters. This is a picture of a permanent hemodialysis catheter. It's called a tunneled catheter. And the central line is inserted into the chest at point number one in that picture, into the subclavian vein, and it travels into the vein and it ends in the junction of the right atrium and the subclavian. The line is tunneled under the skin, and the line comes out at point number three there. And you can see point number three is indicated by the arrow in the picture on the left. This patient has a two-port hemodialysis tunneled catheter. Another type of access that you will see when patients that are undergoing hemodialysis are those AV grafts. And the quickest way to remember that is that an AV graft is essentially a plastic tube that's inserted under the skin, and it connects an artery to a vein by use of the plastic tube. You can see in the picture the hand on the picture on the right, the graph of the arm that shows the graft, is very similar to the picture on the left showing the fellow with the band-aids. It's almost an identical replication of him. There's the artery listed at the top, and through the graft or plastic tube connection, it is then grafted into the vein. When the hemodialysis procedure begins, the nurse accesses one loop of the graft and uses that for arterial access, and then she puts the needle on the other side, and that creates the venous return. Another type of access is the AV fistula, and you will see this is also called the artery vein anastomosis. And that occurs in the picture on the left, where they anastomose, or they tie a vein and an artery together. So that blood that's supplied from the heart down towards the periphery is sometimes shunted back up into the vein. You can see that the direct pressure from that artery going directly into a vein can cause some swelling and some aneurysms. And you will see that these patients often have sort of strange lumps and bumps on their arms, and that's due to the aneurysms from various needles and scar tissue from previous dialysis access. The patient on the right has a fistula surgery scar just above his right wrist, And you can see examples of those aneurysms from the arterial and venous needles as they go through. The further along that this patient develops through his dialysis treatment, the more likely he is to have those sort of abnormalities appear on his arm and in his skin. It's important to know how to manage a patient that has an AV fistula or an AV graft. Primarily, you want to make sure that you're assessing the site. You want to look for complications such as thrombosis and infection, and also for any type of other vascular complications such as clot. When you assess these sites, you want to make sure that you listen with your stethoscope for a brewy and a thrill. A brewy sounds like a sort of shh sound. I know that was highly graphic. And then a thrill occurs when you place your fingers over top of the site. You should feel what feels like sort of a little flutter underneath your fingertips. If you don't feel the flutter, or if you don't feel a vibration, and you don't hear the swishing sound when you listen with your stethoscope, you should contact the physician because the patient may be occluding their site, and that certainly is problematic for their future treatments, and they would have to undergo additional procedures to correct that. It's important for you to recognize nursing diagnoses that are related to dialysis in general, but also to potential complications, and then patient education is also very important. You want to make sure when you tell these patients and teach them about their grafts and their fistulas that you educate them to not wear tight or restrictive clothing on that arm. They want to make sure that they don't allow anyone to perform needle punctures such as lab work or blood pressures or even finger sticks on the arm where they have that dialysis access. They need to avoid sleeping or bending that arm in a prolonged position. So a lot of times when patients will curl up in their sleep, they need to start adjusting and paying attention to moving that arm out of the way. Many of you know that my grandfather was a hemodialysis patient, and he said that when he curled his arm up underneath his pillow to sleep, he could hear the swishing sound and feel the vibration through the pillow onto his ear, and he would then remember to turn over so that he wasn't occluding those access. Again, it's very important that you teach the patient to follow protocols and the care plans that have been set in place by the hemodialysis center and by the hemodialysis nurses in the acute care setting. Physicians will also have very prescriptive protocols that the patient should follow and care plans that the patient should be involved in. There are certain interventions that you as the nurse will have to perform as part of being, if you are a dialysis nurse, you'll be expected to maintain competencies related to sterile technique and also accessing these sites, as well as common knowledge of medications and administration of those medications and fluids to patients. If you're a medical surgical nurse working on a floor in a hospital, you won't necessarily be responsible for knowing the exact procedure of hemodialysis, but to know the principles of hemodialysis when caring for renal patients. It's important for you to implement the teaching that's required and then use evaluation methods such as teach back or having the patient write out the information that you give them or read back to you information provided on a pamphlet. It's important for you to monitor the patient's lab work to see if the hemodialysis has been effective. If the patient has had effective hemodialysis treatment, there will be a decrease in the patient's weight from before the dialysis treatment to after, and the physician will prescribe how many kilograms of weight he wants to have the patient dropped from before treatment to after. And often it's a good amount, 3 to 4 kilograms, which is close to about 3 to 4 liters. It's also important to monitor the lab work before dialysis and after dialysis so that you can determine, has the creatinine actually decreased? Has the BUN decreased? Are the potassium and sodium levels returning to normal? What about the calcium levels? So you'll want to make sure that you're looking at that lab work before you send your patient to dialysis as well as whenever they get back from dialysis. Once your patient returns from the dialysis treatment, it's important to monitor their blood pressure and the remainder of their vital signs to notice the trends that are associated with that and to ensure that your patient does indeed remain hemodynamically stable after such an invasive treatment. I'll return back to talk with you shortly about ultrafiltration.